Hi, welcome to this part of my review featuring Monster Wrangler, the core rulebook. If you haven't seen the other parts of my review featuring this tabletop RPG, where you race, train and fight alongside your monsters, please check out the playlist in the description below. This time we are going to talk about using dice and the different types of rolls. Monster Wrangler uses 10-sided dice to determine whether a character succeeds or fails at an attempted action. When a character in Monster Wrangler attempts to resolve some sort of conflict, he or she must usually make a dice roll to see whether they succeed or fail. To do so, the character first forms a dice pool by gathering the appropriate number of 10-sided dice, as determined by the character's attributes, techniques, and skills. If the character has any bonus dice, typically as a result of various in-game effects, those dice are added to their dice pool at this time. Similarly, if the character has lost dice as a result of an in-game penalty, those dice are removed from the character's dice pool, to a minimum of one remaining die. A character's dice pool can never be reduced below a single die. Once the character has generated their dice pool, they roll the dice and compare the values of those dice to the roll's success value. The success value is the minimum number that the character must roll on a die for that die to be considered a success. The default success value is 7, but this value can be modified by various in-game effects. If a success value improves or is improved by 1, then the required value is lowered by 1. Similarly, if a success value worsens or is worsened by 1, the required value is increased by 1. No matter what, however, a success value cannot be modified below 4 or above 10. Through fortune or luck, characters can sometimes accomplish far more than anyone would have thought possible. When a character makes a dice roll, any die that has a result of 10 is said to explode. Before calculating the success or failure of the roll, the character immediately rolls one additional die. If multiple dice explode, the character rolls one additional die for each such explosion. If any of these additional dice have a result of 10, then those dice explode as well. Now, concerning difficulty, after a character makes a dice roll, the total number of successes rolled by the character is compared against a difficulty that is determined by the game master. Difficulty is a measure of how hard it is to complete a certain challenge. A simple challenge might have a difficulty of 1 or 2, while a more complicated task would have a difficulty of 3 or even 4. Challenges with a difficulty of 5 or higher are quite difficult. Tasks that are inconsequential or virtually impossible to fail, such as sitting down in a chair or walking across a room, do not have difficulties, as characters do not have to roll any dice to accomplish these tasks. If the number of successes generated by the character is equal to or higher than the required difficulty, the character succeeds at the challenge. If the number of generated successes is lower than the required difficulty, the character fails at the challenge. Let's talk about races. When a character succeeds on a dice roll, they are generally considered to have done just well enough to have completed the challenge. Particularly skilled and lucky characters, however, can frequently achieve far more than their less proficient peers. For every success a character achieves in excess of a dice roll's difficulty, they are said to have generated one race. Races can be spent for a variety of effects, such as increasing the amount of damage dealt by a successful attack, or making an effect last for a few rounds longer. Each generated race can only be spent once, after which the race effectively ceases to exist. A character can spend multiple races to activate the same effect multiple times if they wish. When working with skills and techniques, the number of races that must be spent to gain an effect are denoted by the number of race symbols preceding the effect. Race symbols look like purple arrows. Let's talk about the different types of rolls. There are a few different types of dice rolls that characters will frequently be called upon to make during the game. There are attribute rolls. They are the raw physical and mental capabilities of a character. Attribute rolls therefore rely entirely upon the character's innate qualities to avoid or resist some effect, such as becoming stunned or sleeping on ice. When a character makes an attribute roll, their dice pool is equal to their attribute rank. This is usually presented as an attribute roll, using the attribute in question. Then you have skill rolls. They represent education, training, and physical conditioning. So skill rolls are therefore the application of that knowledge and training to the resolution of some problem. While monsters are capable of learning skills, they are most common among wranglers. When a character makes a skill roll, their dice pool is equal to their skill rank plus their attribute rank. This is presented as a skill attribute skill roll. Then you have technique or tech rolls. Techniques are powerful combat maneuvers that are used by monsters. They require the monster to expend a certain amount of rage and are often quite deadly. When a monster makes a tech roll, its dice pool is equal to its tech rank plus its attribute rank. This is presented as technique, attribute, tech roll. There are also cooperative rolls. Sometimes multiple characters decide to work together to accomplish a single goal. When this happens, each character makes a skill roll against the same difficulty, and the successes generated by each character are added together before comparing them to the task's difficulty, ensuring that the characters either succeed or fail as a group. Races generated by the cooperative roll are placed into a communal pool that can be spent by any participating characters as normal. Depending upon the exact task in question, the number of characters who can participate in a cooperative roll might be limited by the game master. For example, a heavy rock might not be large enough for more than 3 characters to attempt to lift. And this concludes this part of the review. In the next part, we are going to talk about attributes and many other things. So everything is quite clear, very well laid out. The roles are simple to understand, and they can produce over-the-top results, as you would expect of a monster trainer type of RPG. Thank you for watching this part of the review, and thank you for your likes and your comments. If you have any questions or comments, please let me know. And thank you so much to those of you that are going the extra mile to support the channel. If anyone else wishes to further support the channel, the information on how to do that will be in the description below. And remember, it is better to roleplay and fail in character than not to roleplay and fail as a player. Once again, thank you, and see you later.